Since you had a heavy meal and kind of feeling a little bit sleepy, so I thought of introduce myself in a little different way. So I'm an Apache committer, so I contribute to many Apache projects. So what I want to tell, I'm technical. So, and I introduce myself as an architect and a technology evangelist. I drive a Mazda, I love Mazda. And I play basketball, so I like Kobe Bryant. If you are a basketball fan. And I live next to the Levi Stadium in Santa Clara. So I like Colleen, he's a famous football player in US. And I listen to Linkin Park. And this is my two kids, okay? That's about me. So the strategy forum, actually we started running a strategy forum during our conferences, I think 2 years back. What we thought kind of identified a middle path, like not too technical, not very visionary, and then have a middle path for especially targeting CIOs, CTOs, as well as enterprise architects to tell and help you to plan your IT vision and your projects. So today actually, so I'm giving the introduction. After that, we thought of talk about APIs. So Isabel will talk about how APIs are important and how you can bring APIs into your architecture and projects. And then we thought of talk about mobile, because mobile is a key driver these days. So how you can build your mobile strategy. And then move into cloud, because cloud is about, everything is about cloud these days. So how you can plan your cloud strategy. And then big data. So Isabel did a really good talk on big data, but Srinath will go into the next level and explain how you can leverage those features. And then finally, Samisa will talk about open source, and then how you can benefit from open source. So that's the strategy forum. So then I'm doing the final keynote, kind of collect everything and then share our experience on how the customers and users of WSO2 build the digital enterprise, and then what we learn and how, and share our experience during that talk. And then after that, there's for the panel there, basically to get some insight from various technology leads. So that's the final session tomorrow. So this is the evolution of computer programming. I think most of you coming from different backgrounds, but if you're coming from a programming background, then you might have started your career at some point. So I started actually around C, assembler, that level, and then I did some assembler programming as well, and then corrupted my hard disk, because when you do assembler, you had to give the exact coordinations. Then I thought of write to the CLR by giving 00, but I gave it to the hard disk, and then it corrupted by writing to the boot sector. So that's how the evolution of computer programming happened. And with that, we identify about the evolution of the platform. So we categorize this thing into three levels. First thing is the platform 1.0, that's where the mainframe and before, that we call as a centralized computing. And then after that, platform 2.0 came. That's about the, that's the most interesting era, basically. The messaging, object orientation, and SOA. So Frank talked detailed about SOA. And then event-driven architecture, distributed computing, and then the power of internet. So today we call it as platform 3.0. Basically, the good things coming from platform 2.0 plus the next generation middleware that we call as the cloud. So the platform 3.0 actually we identify a bunch of cool features there, as well as key features in platform 3.0. So these are the features that we identified. So I'll explain one by one. So first thing called the cloud native. So Paul Fremantle, our CTO, now he's on study leave these days, completing his PhD. So Paul identified a bunch of features that what does cloud native mean. So first thing is about the distributed and dynamically wired, because you know in a cloud infrastructure, the things are getting dynamically created. With that, you need to wire these things dynamically. So that's the first feature that we identified. The second thing is elastic, because you need to dynamically scale, so it should be elastic supported. Not only the infrastructure, then things that you write inside the cloud should be elastic capable. Then the multi-tenanted, because there are two patterns that you can have isolation. First thing that we used to do called the kind of a federated pattern, that you have different type of silos that cater certain functionalities. But multi-tenancy is the next level of federation, that you can use the same environment but having different type of isolated environments for each and every business unit or group to run their own applications. Then the self-service, that's a key feature, that whoever the user should be able to get their stuff done by going through a UI or a command prompt, but it has to be self-service. Then it has to be metered and billed, because it's a shared environment, so you should know who's using what and then how you identified it. And then the last thing is it should be incrementally deployed and tested, because that's where the continuous integration, continuous testing, those type of features coming into the picture. So that's the first feature that we identify in the platform 3.0. Second feature is about open source. So a lot of people think open source is about the financial benefits, but more than that, it's about freedom. So I'm not going to talk in detail, because Samisa will go in detail about the value of open source. Addition to that, actually, the Simon Phipps, like, he did a talk during our last US conference about the open source and the advantages of open source. So when you have a free time, you can go through that as well. Then the next thing is API driven. So next talk is detailed about APIs. So I took this quote, like, a company without API is like a computer without internet. Because if you look at it, like, today, if you have a computer and if you can't connect, you can't get much value. Same way, like, if you can't, as an organization, if you can't connect with your internal stakeholders, like between different business units, or with your partners and then your external world, you are kind of isolated and you can't grow. So that's where APIs will come into the picture. Then the next thing is about polyglot programming, because if you are a project manager or coming from a development, managing a development team, most of the time we set some standards and tell, okay, you should use Java, or you should use .NET or JavaScript or some kind of a language and do your development. But things has changed, especially with the innovation, like we need to give freedom for the developers to pick the language and then build the applications. So the driver for that is APIs, because you expose all your business capabilities as an API, and then you give the freedom for your developers to write applications using any language that they like to do. And platform basically provides some governance as well as some control over what they can do and how they can do, but you give more freedom for your developers. Then the next feature is quality of services, because the traditional way of programming, you add things like security, governance, all these quality of services like caching, throttling, all these things into the code of your application development. But when you build a platform, platform will provide all these features that you can enable, disable based on your usage. So your application logic is not coupled with these capabilities. Based on your usage, you can do that. As example, we can take security. Like, you might enable it for a certain application. The same application might deploy for in a different environment, but you can disable it based on your requirement. So it's not coupled with the application logic. Then the next thing is mobile social store. Like, I don't need to explain much. Sean will go in detail about mobile stuff. So basically, So it's part of our application development. Like when you release an app, like most cases, it should have a web app, and then parallelly, you should have a mobile app as well. And then how you take this into your network basically comes with the store, that you will have a store that advertise all these applications, and people can come, and based on your access rights, they can access this application. So this was a nice feature, actually, as IT teams build applications, because earlier days there was no proper way to advertise the stuff that we do. Basically, a person who knows about that particular URL, they will come and access the application, or person who know that okay, my app is this app is available here, they will download it. But store provide a real good marketplace for us to advertise the stuff that we do, and then people to take it and then run from their devices or from their machines. So that's another really good feature that provide from the platform. Then the next feature is about event-driven nature and IoT. I think you might have used this pattern called publish and subscribe for a while, and it kind of people didn't use it much during last I think 4 or 5 years. But now with the IoT trend, basically event-driven nature and PubSub has become another powerful message exchange pattern. So it should be part of the platform as well. So the power of the PubSub or eventing, basically, it takes the loosely coupling into the next level. Frank in the morning explained about the loosely coupling. So you can take the loosely coupling at to the next level, because you can bring applications and then subscribe for it, so it will be part of your ecosystem. And if you want to take it out, you unsubscribe from that particular application, and then that application will be not part of the system. As well as if you want to introduce a new set of event streams, you can introduce it like that. There's a lot of flexibility we'll bring by the event-driven nature. And personally, it's a architecture pattern and a message exchanging pattern I really like to use when designing and architecting applications. Then big data analytics, nothing to tell. Everybody identified the advantage of big data. Even if you don't have a need now, our advice is at least store the data, then at some point you can use big data analytics and utilize information that you gather from big data. Then the next one is DevOps. Like earlier days when we developed and try to release the applications, we had a lot of challenges because we develop it in a certain way, and then we try to deploy it in our data center or a public hosting place. Then only we identify what are the limitations or the standard that we should have follow to deploy this application. But today it has changed. Most of the development teams, DevOps is part of the development teams from day one. From our experience, when we start designing the system, they involve with us, and then involve from day one, and then work with the project team and define the standards that we should follow, as well as whatever the things that we need to consider by looking at the target deployment. So DevOps is key part of it. From a platform point of view, what we should provide DevOps friendliness, like how they can script the stuff, how they can easily deploy it, how they can automate it. All these features should be supported by the platform. Then the next thing is the iterative nature, because we used to have this pattern called, a method called iterative development, but we are now talking about not only the development, iterative architecture, that you can start from a prototype and then go into the next level and then go to the final design. I think the talk done by Harsha in the morning kind of clearly explained how you can start from a prototype and then take it to the next level. So the next feature of the platform is this iterative approach. So tomorrow, actually, I'm doing a session on iterative architecture. So if you can join, we can go in detail about what's the architecture approach to have a iterative development and architecture. Then if you look at the capabilities the platform should have, we identified there are many capabilities required, but you don't need everything. you can prioritize it. That's where the iterative approach will come into the picture. But we identify these are the core capabilities an enterprise architecture should have. You might have most of these features already running, but you might need to add or introduce some set of features to complete it. But I would like to repeat that it's not a must to have all these features in your design. So we did another exercise by identifying these features, as well as we have 26 products. So how you can map these products into different areas of this enterprise architecture. And if you carefully look at it, we cover almost all the areas in a typical functional architecture like that. Then we tried to simplify this diagram because it's a little bit complicated if you take a look. So we tried to simplify it and then identified high-level platforms that you should have in the bigger picture. So we call it as platform of platforms. So most of the sessions that we have here are kind of focusing on these different platforms and how you can bring it, as example API and then analytics, app development, so and so forth. So these are the platforms of platforms, or the sub platforms that we identified. And you can start from somewhere and then especially like security or integration, and then continue based on that, based on your business requirements as well as your project needs. So the I'd like to explain a little bit about few customer stories. So different customers, they approach in a different way. So I will take a couple of examples. First customer is Kaiser Permanente. Like, they are a California-based healthcare provider. So what they did actually, so they had a proper iterative approach. So they were using mainframe stuff for most of the core healthcare functionalities. And then they want to connect with outside world using this protocol called HL7. So what they did, there's a guy called Mark Anderson, if you have heard about him. Like, he wrote some service-oriented architecture related information those days. So he wrote a utility that can convert the mainframe functionality in functionalities as a service. So that's the first step they did. And then they took our enterprise service bus and built an integration platform that all the export services are kind of proxy through the ESB as a shared service. And then they did a lot of service orchestration, kind of choreography, those type of functionalities inside the ESB, and then made the backend services as a proper shared service through ESB. So that was their integration layer. And later on, they identified they need to release a mobile app with the same functionality that they had in their web application, and they introduced the API management system into the picture. So with the API management, they identified, okay, we need security and we need more governance. So they introduced the API platform and then the governance platform into the system as well. So that was their approach to platform, and then introduced one by one. And if we take another example, like Boeing, like what they did, try to build a platform that developers can come and build applications inside their platform. It's the app dev platform. Again, they started with the integration layer to integrate all their backend services and then expose them as shared services. Then got the API management stuff, and they need more governance. So they took the governance as the next step. And then they even help us to create a new product called App Manager, that how a developer can develop an app and then take it to production through the app life cycle, like from dev to test to dev to QA, QA to test, and then test into production, like that. So they managed to do that through the app dev platform as well. Then the so those are kind of the technical stuff, like how you can build a platform. But when we deal with most of this implementation, the most of the difficult part is the political part, like how you can introduce the new system and implement it inside with help of the current people working in your project. So I read this book actually, written by a guy called Dave Gray. He came to one of our conference like in 2014 US conference and did a nice talk as well. So Dave basically in this book explained like what are the necessary steps that you should take to bring the technology and then these technical practices into your work environments without doing much changes, and then how you can onboard people and then convince them into your new platform. So it's a really nice book, and then he has different type of patterns with more examples as well. So I highly recommend it, like to read this book if you find a chance. They have the hard copy as well as the soft copy as well. So that's it as a start for the strategy forum.